What's going on, y'all? Welcome back. We are finally back with episode number 47 here on Debate and Destroy with yours truly, Black Cow Bill, joined by my co-host, as always, the fiend from Carrizo Springs.
Local JJ.
Local JJ Del Toro's in the motherfucking house. Dude, that's good to be back.
Literally, my house.
Literally, your house. If you didn't notice, we changed sets. Uh-oh. Watch out. And that is the reason we've been gone for so long.
Yeah,
we didn't catch the state of the pod. Fucking no place to record for about 6 months because of fucking COVID. Fuck that shit.
Oh my God. But we are back. A lot of shit.
And there's only one man who could do the return with us. The man himself, the metal mechanic, Mr. Samuel. Samwise Ganji.
The Destroyer.
Samwise the Brave. Fuck yeah. Oh shit, dude. How do you feel to be back?
It's good to be back.
I know.
Yes.
Dude.
Not good to be back here. This is the first time
here. Yeah, that's true. But good to be back on the show, dude.
Oh, yeah. Missed it a lot.
I missed it so much, too, man. So, obviously, today we're doing Children Bodom, Are You Dead Yet? From 2005, September 2005, and Arch Enemy Doomsday Machine, also from 2005 in July. Only a couple months apart.
I know, dude.
I'm the one that picked this.
I know.
Yeah, and I love doing that. I love making it so that they're at least in the same year or close enough to each other.
Yeah. And
they are very close.
Were there any other reasons? I mean, maybe the geography too. Swedish and Finland. I mean, both Scandinavian.
Pretty close in a way. Yeah. Really just some good melodic death metal going on.
Very true. Exactly. Yeah. Melodic death metal, but like definitely their own take on it, right? Like,
because you got one that's playing with the keyboards, you got the other one that's just doing the full-on guitar harmonies and everything.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, and Children Bodom is like neoclassical, like up the ass, like take Vivaldi and just transpose it on fucking on up keyboard.
And during
right?
this album, they really changed, because I don't know if you heard the one before, but it's super like close to power metal, or maybe it is power metal.
Hatebreeder?
No. It has some influence.
No, Hatebreeder's more mellow death, dude. This one's more like metal.
I thought that was the one after. Hatebreeder's after.
No, Hatebreeder's the second album. So it's Something Wild, Hatebreeder. Then it's Follow the Reaper, I think, right?
Follow the Reaper is really good too.
That one's closer to this. Was it the blue album? Fuck, I forgot.
Yeah, that's the blue
one. Green is the Hatebreeder's green. That one's the most like mellow death of theirs that I can think of. Maybe I haven't heard the first one in so long.
See, admittedly, the only two albums of theirs I've heard are this and Blood Drunk.
Really? You haven't heard
Dude, Hex is really good. If you haven't heard it, that's
the new one's really good. Yeah,
their last album actually. Now they're called Bodom After Midnight.
Bodom After Midnight. That's right, dude.
I think it was Roop left, and then after that, it was just like, well, let's make a different band.
And once we get to like the intermission, we got to talk about when we saw Children of Bodom, because I got to address that whole thing, like what's going on. But we'll talk about that more towards the intermission.
If we're gonna do that same thing, we got to talk about when we saw Arch Enemy together and separate at the same
time. That was a good story. So with this one, there were the same amount of tracks. If we just took away the instrumentals from the Arch Enemy album, so they could line up. So pretty easy. If you never tuned in before, we go track for track. The track that gets the 2 out of 3 votes gets a Pentagram of Truth. The album that has more Pentagrams of Truth at the end of the debate is the winner here on Debate and Destroy.
That's right.
And if you think the other one won, what's their opinion, JJ?
They're wrong.
You're wrong.
That's
You're
it.
Wrong. That's it.
That's it. That's all.
No, not really. Everyone's got different opinions, but we like to... That's our inside. Let's go. So let's start this motherfucker off, dude. This is a battle.
This is a battle.
This is a battle. So Living Deadbeat versus Taking Back My Soul. Who wants to start this shit?
Honestly, I'm just going to say this. The first three tracks on these albums, every single one of them is going to be a battle for the first three.
Yeah, I really enjoy all of them.
These A-sides are pretty fucking hard to decide on. But I don't know which one you guys want to start with.
So I'm just going to say this right now. Living Deadbeat, that right there is a fighter's anthem.
Oh, yeah.
You get in every single second of that song.
Dude, that keyboard intro, bro.
Yeah. Ooh, dude, I was about to say, that intro, that's definitely one of those things that sets Children of Bodom apart. Like, it's their sound. Like, for better or for worse.
It makes it significant. Like,
it does.
Them.
That tone is just, you know, right away when you hear it, like, oh, that's Children of Bodom. Like, it's... I don't want to say cheesy, but sometimes those keys come off as cheesy. I think I talked about on the Hexed episode.
You throw the same thing on there with power metal. It's just like, it's all too cheesy. Me, I love that feel. You throw a keyboard in with some shredding D-tune, C-tune guitars. Like, man, that sounds great.
It's pretty funny because the lyrics are dark, but it does with the keyboard. It makes it really happy.
Like a poppy sound. And they're going for like that neoclassical thing together. But this song in particular, like... there's cheese that I like, right? Like, I love Hatebreed, right? In the gym, like, Hatebreed gets me up. But am I not going to sit here and say Hatebreed's a little bit cheesy? It's a little bit cheesy. You know what I mean?
We're a bit.
Grown men, you know, in their khakis screaming about, you know, being disciplined and shit is a little cheesy. But it's cheese. I love cheese. Maybe this one's maybe not like a, you know, like a 10-year fermented cheese, but it's maybe more along the lines of cottage cheese. Like, I like it sometimes, but
yeah.
I don't like it all the
That's
time.
That's a lot of cheese.
Right. Every meal. That'd be a lot. But,
oh, God, no.
But Living Deadbeat, dude, the groove smacks with those fucking verses. Gosh, those riffs are really good. Yes. And
the solo for the keyboard is where it's at.
This is one of my I like this keyboard solo more than some of the others, because some of the others sometimes I feel like they don't fit as well. But I thought this one, because from the very start, it's keyboard driven. You know what I mean? That it just like adds on to that. So I thought the solo is really
the
good.
The solo is the star of the show for this. And the song for particular for me, oh my God, I love it. I listen to that part all the time.
Yeah. That is one of the few songs that are on both of these albums I have on my playlist. It is so good.
Oh yeah. This one smacks. And what I love about Children Bodom, it's their go-to, but when they harmonize Alexi's guitar with the keyboardist.
Yes.
What's the keyboard's name? Jana? John A? John.
Oh, that's a pronunciation right there.
No, Johnny, I can't
Johnny,
say it.
It might be with us.
Yeah, Johnny Veerman, I think.
I think it's Johnny.
It might. Hey,
I don't think
Scandinavian. Who knows?
Who knows?
You might be right. It might be Johnny.
My heritage is just spitting at me that I can't pronounce. Well, they're Finnish. So Finnish, they don't even speak fucking. It's not similar to like Norwegian or Swedish. It's more like Croatian. So I don't know. I have no idea how it's pronounced.
Who knows?
And we just, all of our Finnish fans just turned off now.
Oh, it's over. Like, it's fuck over. Those guys.
It's like, man. What are the game dogs playing right now?
I got a whole rant about Finland, but I'll wait on that.
Oh my gosh, here we go.
We'll worry about the next time I bring you a Finnish band to talk about.
I know, right? But dude, Alexi kills on like his vocal deliveries here. Like the verses, I think he sings them really well. And then I've always liked his voice because he keeps that like the guttural, right? There's a guttural part of it, but there's always melody behind it, like in his choruses. And
not everyone
for
can
this
do that.
Album. He's really hit or miss.
This one,
this particular album, he's not. It's not my favorite, man.
So we'll talk about that on one of the later songs. So I do agree with that, but specifically on this song, I disagree.
On this song, he rocks it.
Yeah, like, he kills it on this one.
His grasp of the English language has a few moments of the lyrics definitely. Not making sense.
It could be it too. I don't know.
Yeah, there's definitely translation error. Like, what's that one? Kicked in spleen or
kick
whatever.
In the spleen. Yeah,
it's like not grammatically correct. But you know what? If the song smacks,
it's banging.
They are forgiven. You know what I mean? I don't give a shit. But let's switch over to Arch Enemy, dude. Taking Back My Soul, bro.
Well, I personally, since we took out the instrumental and since it's the beginning, I actually just combined them because I like the way it grows into it. Like, it transitions to it really well.
It does transition really well. And, you know, the Amat brothers, dude, they just got to show you what they can do, man. Yeah. You're talking about two of the goats. No, dude, Michael's the goat, dude. He's up there.
Yes. Hey, Chris is playing for Dark Tranquility now.
Oh, that's right. I did see that he moved
over there.
And they
got some good stuff in their last album.
Yeah, what was the last one? Eczema?
I don't know.
Eczema or some shit?
Oh, yeah, it starts with an E.
Yeah.
Or E.
A-E, it's one of those. I legitimately can't remember. I just know that they're supposed to be going in for a new album. Like, sometime
this year. Cool. That'd be cool to hear what he does with that. Because Dark Tranquility's definitely had like ups and downs in their career. But
I think they're underrated, personally. I like them a lot.
Yeah, they are. You know, I thought Character's a good album. The Gallery's a classic.
I just know every single time Therein comes on my playlist, I love the hell.
Which
it.
One?
Therein.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's a good one. The one I always laughed at was when I used to have the Google Play music from like the music I, you know, had back when I had CDs and put it on. Yeah. Was that
illegally downloaded?
Illegally. No, don't say that. I never did that. I never participated in that.
No. You would have friends that would just go, here's a hard drive. And it has it. You didn't download it.
Exactly.
They did.
What's it called? There was one, I think it's on Character, and it's called like MI1. But like it would have the character I instead of one, so it was like MII, and me and my brother would always laugh like I don't know, MII,
MII,
MII, but
he me,
dude, the fucking harmonics with those guitars, man, when they come in just blazing with Taking Back My Soul, dude.
The guitar work on this song is
fucking just right after the drums, just the guitar comes in and
God, it sounds so heavy too. Yeah. Oh, I love it.
The guitar work is killer. That 2 minute mark when they come in is killer.
Yes. Exactly.
The gripe I would say with this song compared to Living Deadbeat is that the chorus is not as good. I know they're only going for just guttural, like, if anyone's going to argue that out there. But, like, for me personally, I kind of like the melody because you can scream along with it.
Yeah.
To me,
yeah.
that makes, like, a catchy chorus. So you're, like, singing and you want to learn the lyrics and shit because right. you're like, damn, that's catchy. Yeah, but this one, it's kind of like
opposite on that.
Yeah.
I've always felt, like, from what I've heard at least, I'm wearing an Arch Enemy shirt. I'm not a biggest fan of their earlier days.
Yeah.
I don't feel like Angela was, like, she's a great guttural vocalist, but. The harmony. Oh,
the melodic. Yeah, the melody is different. Yeah.
Yeah. She's not singing along while she's screaming.
But
she's
some people really do prefer that. Right. You know what I mean? And I can kind of get behind it. I just think this song, when you have what's fucking Michael on, you know, doing your guitar work, I think it just begs for like a melodic S screamer. You know what I mean? Yeah. So that part kind of took me away. But there are other songs on this album where I think there are melody. Like definitely when we get to Nemesis. Like,
We'll talk about that.
No, exactly. So that's why I personally think it's actually refreshing that there's no actual melodic chorus.
Yeah, it's just hard.
It's just hard, dude. Because
in a lot of these songs. It's less melodic and more regular death metal.
Yes, exactly. Because in a lot of these songs, it can get a little stagnant because there is too much melody. They can be.
No, that's true. I will say as these albums went on, both of them did begin to get a bit stale.
It can get a little tiresome. I mean, they're banging. It's don't get me wrong, but it can get tiresome.
I agree with you. It's like when you go down the rabbit hole, and you know me, dude. Like when I went down the mellow death rabbit hole, it's just they do it so similarly to everyone else in that genre that you're like,
too
all right, I know what they're doing here.
Exactly.
Here
that's why I think it's a little refreshing that you don't get that.
The same reason why you've told me it's like I'm not a big fan of power metal. It's like because it's the same.
It's very, you know what's coming. And not to say that I don't like it when it's done like really well, but it's like you said, you just get lost with so many bands that are doing the same thing. You're like, all right, well, this is cool, but I could find a band that fucking does it way better. So
Exactly. Sometimes they just mimic each other and that becomes cheese.
Yeah, that comes a little cheese. That's what I'm saying. Even though, you know, Children of Bodom has that cheesy side and a lot of metalheads, I'm sure, get turned off with that keyboard. I cannot think of a band that sounds like Children of Bodom.
No.
They're definitely set themselves apart with
them. They are unique.
So we started talking about Arch Enemy and then went right back to Children of Bodom.
Oh, sorry. Well, we can talk about Taking Back My Soul.
These songs are neck and neck to me.
That 2 minute riff when the fucking guitar and the drums match that groove, that shit smacks. Yeah. And then that switch halfway, like they just completely switch it on its head. I love that stuff. And the harmonized guitar parts are always great. So, fuck, what can I say, dude? Both these songs are killing.
They both smack. That's for sure.
I have my choice, but.
I have my choice, too.
I have mine, too.
What do you guys go? Who's going to start this off?
It's really neck and neck for me, man. But like I said, like throughout the entire both albums, you get a little stale. And I just think Taking Back My Soul is pretty refreshing. And I really like it. The guitar work is phenomenal.
Damn.
I think the guitar work is better than Living Dead Beat on just this song alone. So I'm taking back my soul.
I would say guitar and it is work, a single. Yes, but I feel like the production of almost every other instrument on Living Dead Beat comes out being a bit better.
That could be true. That could be argued. Could be argued. Although the production on both these albums, I was impressed. They were both really good. You know?
But like we said, the keyboard was fantastic.
Yeah.
The drums were fantastic. Personally, I'm going Living Dead Beat.
You can't go wrong with either one.
You really can.
No. What are you going
with? So for me, I think they're both fucking awesome songs. This one was probably one of the harder ones. Like we said, these first three are really fucking hard.
Yeah.
But for me, I think I'm going to go Living Dead Beat too. Yeah. For me, it's just like, it's a more memorable song. You know what I mean? Like every time I throw one Living Dead Beat, there is no other Living Dead Beat, dude.
Yeah.
There's no song that sounds, or there may be a couple songs by Bodom that sound like that, but there's no other bands like in the genre I can think of that sound anywhere near that. So it's unique. It's more memorable. Taking Back My Soul is a good song on this album. I don't think it's one of the best.
No, no.
And I think Living Dead Beat could be argued that it might be the best song on the album.
You think it's the best? No, I don't think it's the best.
It's top three.
Wait, Living Dead Beat as being the best?
I don't know about
that. It's top three.
I would argue it's top three.
Okay, it's top three. Sorry. I'll go back. It's top three, but Taking Back My Soul is not top three.
No.
I don't think so.
No. Good song.
There's some cool... Because we'll get to it, dude. The B-sides on this album are fucking good. Like, they're really good. So, Living Dead Beat, that means it gets the pentagram of truth.
What's funny is my first, I just did my first listen, and I was like, Living Dead Beat's better. And then I just kept going and going. I was like, I like Taking Back My Soul better.
Well, honestly, neck and neck. I'll do that constantly when I'm on the shows with you guys. I have my selection of, okay, what am I doing? But I may change my mind midway through our conversations and go, you know what? Maybe you're right.
Yeah, I agree.
And I'll switch sides.
There's some, especially the ones that are like super close. Like, that's a good point. You know what I mean?
This one was close, but not as close as...
This is the hardest one, dude. The two singles, the two bangers, the two probably most memorable songs on both albums. Maybe not on the Children of Bodom. It's probably top three, but Nemesis is definitely the biggest song on the album.
That's probably the biggest.
Nemesis is my favorite song on on the record. Arch Enemy album.
Yeah, it's probably the best. And you can tell why it's the best.
If not my favorite Arch Enemy song.
Sorry, so I didn't say Are You Dead Yet versus Nemesis. But go ahead. Okay.
Yeah, I think Nemesis is probably my favorite Arch Enemy song.
The guitars are so blistering, yes, man. It's crazy.
Every single time.
Just both of these songs start off with super iconic, like, guitar riffs. Yes. Especially now that it's been fucking 15 years since these albums came out.
And they
still
hit hard.
They both, like, they just are that callback. Because I remember the first time I heard fucking Are You Dead Yet. It must have been, like, 2008, because I was a freshman in high school. So, like, I remember that song fucking smacking the first time I heard it. And I still put it on. I'm like, dude, that's such an iconic, like, intro. Nemesis I probably heard a couple years later, but it's still, like, fucking fast, dude.
Yes,
fast and good.
Nemesis, I first heard, it was on a Guitar Hero. It was one of the DLC tracks for, I believe, 5 or Warriors of Rock. It was
what?
One of them. Yeah.
Oh, shit.
And so I remember my brother, because we bought the, I think it came with the whole metal track set list.
Yeah.
And one of the other ones on there was Twilight of the Thunder God.
What? That was on Guitar Hero?
That was on Guitar Hero.
God damn it, dude. Yeah.
So
I was about to talk about If You Want Peace, Prepare for War.
That one's on Guitar Hero.
That one's also on Guitar Hero.
Which one is it on? Do you remember?
It's also, I think it's also in the exact same DLC pack.
Okay. Really? I remember having
either that or it's on 5.
I think it's on Warriors. I think it's on, or not War. What's the last
Warriors
one?
No, you're right. Warriors of Rock was on. Yeah, yeah. It was on there. It was Done With Everything, Die for Nothing that was on the Guitar Hero 5's DLC pack.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. And I remember loving If You Want Peace, Prepare for War. But Nemesis, dude, playing that Guitar Hero. I bet it was fucking hard.
Oh, God. Well, I mean, I was always bass. My brother was the one that was guitar, and he was like, hey, check this out. And he put it on, just that intro just coming in.
Oh yeah. Oh, just nasty, dude.
It is in your face. Dude, solo is just wow.
Oh, the solos go crazy.
It's so nasty. I love it.
The verses are a little carcassy. There's a couple times where there's one moment in particular on this album where I'm like, that's Carcass. But obviously, Michael was in Carcass. But the verses have reminded me of Carcass for some reason.
If I have
to
nitpick, though, there's only one thing I don't like.
I
think we're about to agree on this. The haze.
Oh, come on.
The haze.
Why did they bring that on the album?
It's great live.
It is great live.
No,
you're right.
Studio doesn't work.
But that was part of the, dude, that was part of the era.
Yeah.
I think that really, that like doing that in your studio album has not aged well and will never, but he's right.
And yet Testament still seems to keep doing it.
But why is it that, like, I just buy Chuck Billy's, like,
there's some things that, some songs that work, some don't, and particularly this one doesn't work.
This
man.
One doesn't work.
But
song,
take that out, this
song
is perfect.
Nothing else about
that song
is bad.
No, exactly. That's exactly what I'm getting
And like
to.
Sam said, dude, when you go see it live, you know you're going to be like,
every single person in that crowd is shouting, hey.
Yeah.
That's a banger, dude. That part is just a little cringy.
Yeah.
But besides that, the song is just perfect. Oh, my God.
Dude, and the 235 breakdown. Watch out! Watch out! All right, but let's talk about Are You Dead Yet, man?
Dude, 13 seconds in, Alex scream is boss, dude.
I
love his
scream,
man.
What's it called, dude? Those squealies and the double bass on the second riff, just fucking awesome. Yeah. And like I said, again, these guys fucking grooving on the verses with the panning of the guitars.
Groovy and catchy.
Oh, my God, dude. I love Children of Bodom for that. Like, it's so sick. Oh, go.
With the chorus.
Yeah.
We were talking about with the last track, the way that he's singing while screaming at the same time, keeping it very melodic. I love the way that he's doing the vocals there.
I agree.
It is necessary.
You want one?
I'll have one in a second. Okay. But I agree, dude. His... what's it called? The actual vocal delivery on the chorus, you're right. Like, the melody's there, and everyone's singing. Like, we saw children, everyone's singing that song. Are you dead again? But, dude, that I can't get over the verse. Like, because I don't know if it was when I originally heard this album. Like I said, it was back in, like, 2008. I don't know if I didn't have, like, stereo in my headphones, but I do not remember it panning like that. Like, it was so fucking sick. I love that. And then they keep adding little like motifs on top of it.
Yes.
You know, every time they go back to the guitars. But yeah,
there's
Alexis
a lot of
on
layers
point.
To the song.
Yes.
That's great. It's just great.
It's a fucking great one, dude. And then the harmonized keys and guitar, dude, I think they fucking kill it. But yeah, dude, I don't know, man. Did you think when we saw them, this was the song of the night?
It was close. I like In Your Face a lot.
In Your Face, yeah, that was a good one.
That's in my top three.
Yeah. Like would you guys say this is the best? You said Nemesis is the best
Nemesis
song.
Nemesis is the best song on that album.
Would you think Nemesis is the best song on the Arch Enemy album? It's the best one on Doomsday Machine?
Particularly for me, no.
So for me, I do have the nostalgia for it. So that is part of the reason for me.
Yeah.
I will admit to that.
It's either number one or number two for me, for sure.
It's definitely number two for me. There's another one I just fucking love.
Oh, yeah. We'll get to the one that I was just like taken aback by. But what about Are You Dead Yet? Is that the best song, the title track?
I think so, actually.
So I would definitely say it's top three.
It's easily. Top three, yeah.
Next track is...
Oh, I was about to say. I was just about to say, dude, the next track is so fucking
I
don't know. Bad.
I love My Guitar Hero. I just do.
I know, I agree.
It's close. It's really close.
But from
did we already talk about this? What's the best Guitar Hero?
It was easily Warriors of Rock.
Was that three or the last one?
No,
was
that's the
last
one.
With
one.
Dave
yeah, oh, yeah, with Dave Mustaine. You mean Guitar Hero Megadeth?
Yeah. So technically, if you want to talk song list, and you're talking start to finish, every single song on it being good, the best one was Guitar Hero Metallica.
Oh,
that was good.
That fucking, what song by Machine Head was on there?
Dude, Machine Head?
Rage.
It was from, The Blackening. It's the fucking Beautiful Morning. Beautiful Morning was on there.
Oh, yes.
Atlanta
Guy. Or Aesthetics of Hate. One of the two. Had Laid to Rest? I fucking forgot about that.
No, it didn't have Laid to Rest.
It had a Lamb of God song.
Guitar Hero 2 had Laid to Rest on it.
Oh, see.
There's another one.
But they probably brought it back because I think they brought...
Mm-mm, that was for... they brought back...
dude, I could have
sworn. It was
sworn.
Greatest Hits. They did Smash Hits. Guitar Hero Smash Hits. And it
That's
had
right.
a whole
You're
bunch
right.
of the old yeah. tracks.
I don't remember. But I know it had a bunch of Lamb of God.
Sam, there. What was the best Guitar Hero guitar? Now that's a hard one.
Dude, I still have the axe, that black axe. That
the black... Oh, from 3? The, yeah. I would say the best one's the Explorer from 2.
So the Explorer for the for the Xbox version of 2 was real nice because it plugged in through USB, so you can still use it to this day without an adapter because Clone Hero's out. So you can just use Clone Hero, download all the songs you want, and continue playing Guitar Hero.
Really? On what, like on Xbox?
On PC.
Oh, on PC. Yeah. Damn it.
They have a build for Mac.
Oh, really? You think I could run it on here?
Yeah.
I get addicted. Yeah, I don't think I could do it.
Dude, I have my Warriors of Rock guitar for the Xbox 360. I have a wireless adapter that allows me to hook up my Xbox 360 Warriors of Rock guitar to it, which my answer, that's the best Guitar Hero
I saw
guitar.
People like on YouTube like create their own customized. Yeah. Some guy had a Slayer Kerry King War Axe.
Oh, for like the Guitar Hero guitar? Yeah, oh my god, dude, that's ridiculous.
That's pretty, so cool.
I'm a little
though.
Jealous, but that's a little that's a little overboard.
But so I have almost 800 songs on download to Clone Hero.
Jesus,
and
dude,
it's
a
whole
that's
a bunch
party.
Of set lists from the older games.
Yeah.
A few from Rock Band, and also a few custom ones that people have made. I have fucking Eagle Fly 3 by Helloween on there.
Jesus, that's fucking awesome. So are the hammer-ons and pull-offs good? Like, do they work well?
Oh, it's almost a direct recreation of Warriors of Rock.
Oh,
so,
fuck, so they're like perfect.
It's the perfect engine.
Oh, shit,
just,
I need to do that, dude.
They just introduced drum support also.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Damn.
So I'm currently on the set list for Guitar Hero Metallica, so we can figure out which song.
It was Aesthetics of Hate, I believe. It was either Aesthetics or Beautiful Morning. We'll find out.
So for Machine Head, it was Beautiful Morning.
I got it. Should have gone with my gut.
As far as Lamb of God goes,
maybe Redneck.
I don't know.
Why wouldn't they put Redneck?
Because
it's so
nothing,
big. Nothing.
There was no
so
Lamb
it
of God
was. Later Rest was on 2. Though.
It was on 2.
It was on 2.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got messed up.
Oh damn, man. Well, fucking. Let's get back.
Oh, right, Nemesis.
We
my
went
vote,
on a
my
fucking
votes for Nemesis.
Nemesis. Mine's Are You Dead Yet, dude?
Yeah, same here. Are You Dead Yet?
Oh, I love Are You
I
Dead Yet.
I cannot blame you guys for that one. It's a good choice.
Yeah, they're both again, like tomorrow. My opinion could be Nemesis.
Exactly.
It was just today when I did the back and forth. I was just like, I gotta go. Are You Dead Yet, man? I can't vote against it. Like there was something just calling me about it. It was just me singing the chorus. I think that's what it did. Although the Nemesis chorus. Yeah,
dude, I just, the chorus is so good, but I just remember going and seeing them live and just them going, one for all.
Oh, yeah. All and, for and, one.
And
yeah.
everyone at the exact same time, myself included, just shouts, we are Nemesis. And the guitar starts up.
Dude, get
oh,
up.
Fuck yeah. That was a good time, man, at the Aztec.
Yeah.
That was a banging show, man. It was a Monomarth, Arch Enemy, Grand Magnus.
But I did see them with Trivium.
At the gates.
Who
was the worst one there?
That was disappointing, dude. Yeah. And, dude, I love At the Gates. If everyone knows this. I mean, we had the At the Gates first BDM episode. I love At the Gates. But, dude, recently live, the last two times I've seen them. What the fuck, man?
I don't know what's up with them.
Dude, what's Thomas's voice? Like, I can't.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Just can't anymore.
He just cannot. Slaughter!
It's really bad.
Slaughter! I mean, he's in his late 40s now. I mean, not everyone can
keep or probably 50.
That.
That's true.
No,
and just
his
like slow ass headbang.
Yeah.
But the one that always gets me is when they do the war with reality. I'm just like, no, honestly, please God.
The mixing on that entire set was just
weird. It was weird. I think that was a problem with it too. And like,
also following Grand Magus, just three guys on stage having fun, just doing what they do.
Yeah, that was definitely a big change because the at the gates is the, you know, the Slayer puka 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 puka.
Yeah.
So it was a little too intense. I think that they did dial in the mix weird too. Yeah. And they were third down. That's crazy at the gates. You know what I mean?
That's crazy.
But then Arch Enemy came on and slaughtered it. And then of course Amon Amarth is always fucking great.
I don't believe they can ever put out a bad performance.
No, dude, they fucking rule. Like their every time I see them, they fucking rule. Oh, yeah. The show's good. Yeah. Everyone's always on point. They're very professional. They get the crowd. Like there's a reason why they're so fucking big. You know what I mean?
They're a fun fucking band.
Yeah, they're like the perfect headliner. You know what I mean? I know for all like the European festivals they're headlining, here in the U.S. they don't really.
Did they do Vakken when you saw them?
They did. They were one of the headliners when I was at Vakken. And that was definitely the best time I saw them. That was insane. Bro, raise your horn. God, the whole crowd chanted.
Yes.
Oh, that was too much, dude. That made my life.
All
them beer drinkers.
My throat was dead by the time that song came on.
Oh, yeah, I know.
That's hilarious.
And I love the is this cool or whack? The rowing in the pit, cooler whack,
dude. That's fun. That's
unique. No, JJ.
Come on, dude. You don't see it anywhere.
I would definitely say it's unique. If another band came along and started doing that, then it's like you stole that from Amon Amarth.
Exactly.
If any other band did, I would
pull
agree
that off.
Exactly.
Only they.
I don't know. I feel like they could have a better. It just looks so stupid. Like I can't.
Vikings,
dude. But it doesn't. It's not cool. Well, like it's just air.
Time,
like
at the same time, there's a giant blow up Jormungandr that Johan later goes on and beats with a hammer.
Okay, that's awesome. That's cheese. Yes. But in the live perspective,
cheese also.
Yeah, but in a live perspective, with the lights down, like the blow up looks kind of whack, but not that
it's
whack. But seeing a bunch of grown ass men like just
fake
rowing.
I
want
to go to Vakken just to
do that. Why not this? Why not have a guy dressed as Odin and another guy dressed as Loki just go into the pit and just duke it out, and everyone's just roughing them up? Like having
a door because the Aztec's too small to do that.
Well, the Aztec, but like another venue, you know,
that would be pretty.
Well,
cool
Aztec, they had the guys fight. Oh, the first.
But they had them fight on stage.
Yeah,
but
they had them on stage. Cool. He's talking about going into the.
They
cloud.
Should go not with weapons or anything. Maybe like styrofoam weapons. They should have like. their road hand, like the roadies, whoever's, because it's probably their techs or the roadies that are doing that thing on stage.
Like
but have them go into the, because Alex and I were joking the first time we saw Amon Amarth. After the show, we're like, dude, the next time we see them, we should dress up. Like, we should just, someone's dressed up as Odin, someone Thor, someone Loki, and then we just fucking have a fun ass time in the pit.
Oh,
I was
dude,
like, no, Amon Amarth should do that, because people would get so hyped, and, you know, Johan, you know, he's all like melodramatic on stage, like, over there, I see the deceiver of the gods.
I could definitely
and then
see
everyone's
that.
Like, where? Where? Yes. And then dude, Loki just comes in. You're like, oh, I'm going to fuck him
and
up
it's
in the pit.
Over.
Real quick.
Yeah.
On the next episode of the Amon Amarth Comedy Hour, we talk about two albums that have nothing to do with Amon Amarth.
On that note, are you dead yet? Not the pentagram of truth. Fuck you, Sam.
I had to.
It's all good.
It also helps I'm wearing my Dragon Ball Z socks today. So.
Oh, Jesus. Dude,
it's on.
Side note, I watched a little bit of Super. Got kind of caught up. It's kind of whack.
I'm not a big fan of Super.
It's a little whack.
I see it.
Maybe I've just gotten older, but Jesus
Christ. The writing is not good.
The animation, dude. I was like, what the fuck is this?
It has its moments of being all right, and then its moments of not being all right. Vegeta grew a foot and a half between Z and Super.
Really?
That
He's
is
now
definitely
taller
true.
Than Bulma.
And what is up with, who's the one who does Goku? Sean
Schimmel,
What is up with Sean? Like, is his voice acting just gotten worse? He just makes Goku sound like he's an idiot, like even more of an idiot.
That's the problem. That's the writing of Super the Japanese side. Not Sean Schimmel's fault. In fact,
I feel like some of his delivery, I'm like, what? And there's one part where he's like,
power up so much at this point.
That's true. That's a lot of yelling.
That being said, when he re-recorded his lines for Dragon Ball Z Kai, like he just sounded fantastic.
I remember that, but I remember, dude, there was something about Super, I'm like, it's too much.
Yeah.
Yeah,
they
exactly.
took out of the what?
Oh, the brutality.
Some of it, because
they
you have to remember it was originally aired on TV at a different time, but the Blu-rays still have a good amount of it. You're just not going to see the giant hole in Raditz.
Yeah, it was more the soundtrack that I didn't like for Kai.
Yeah, there's a reason for that. The composer was stealing other people's music.
Yeah, I remember you. We talked about this in the Stradivarius because you stole from Stradivarius. I remember that. Classic. All right. Classic. Are you dead yet? We went on a little bit of tangent. Got the pentagram of truth. All right. Going. Got the motherfucker. I can't even talk. You motherfuckers. Track number three, If You Want Peace, Prepare for War versus My Apocalypse.
Wait. If you want peace, prepare for war, dude.
Dude, just this, oh my God.
Open
dude,
it up,
when
dude.
We saw Children, that was song of the night, dude.
The pit was heavy.
I did not think they were going to play that song because I didn't see it on the set that I remember looking at, and oh my God, the pit fucking came alive, dude. Yeah, that same. Was great. That song smacks so
it's
fucking
so
up,
much
because that buildup, and then when he finally hits the go, dude, little. Oh, that's just too banger, much, dude. Man. And then that fucking bass. Isolated baseball.
One of my favorite parts.
Oh, I love that shit. Is he walking it or is he playing with a pick?
See, I'm not 100% sure. I think he's never seen them live. I haven't seen music videos or anything like that.
You know, I don't even remember.
I think he was playing with a pick. I'm probably someone's going to correct me, but yeah. And that's Hinka. That's how I'm going to say his name.
Hinka. But the bass lines on this is really good.
Oh, I know, dude. Yeah. I mean, what can we say about this song?
And once again, they go back and forth with a keyboard and a guitar. It's great.
Yeah, the way that they're soloing, just one after the other.
Yes, and I love the stops, like the guitar stops during the verses. Once again, that they pull that trick, but it just works, dude, because it gives it a lot more variety when on that second verse where they put the little, you know, like guitar, whatever it might be, like he'll do a harmonic, then he'll do like a little solo, little thing, little diddle, and come
just
back
like
to
the little guitar fills in.
Yeah, and it just it's fucking awesome. There we go. Good guitar fills. The guitar fills in between are just sick.
Which is funny because you don't get a lot of bands that do guitar fills lately. It's
I
bass
know.
Fills that are doing it. And the guitars are even drum strumming fills. Along. Nowadays, it's just like, oh, you get a bass fill at the end while the guitar is chugging along. In this one, the bass is chugging along the whole time, and the guitar is doing
Oh, they're just going crazy.
Oh, yeah. The bass is intense on this
one. It is. I was thinking about that with Guitar Heroes. I used to always play that one on bass, and that was like one of my favorite ones because people, like, if you've never seen the bass tabs of Guitar Hero, if you're just like an amateur player, if it's an open note, it's just a purple line. Yeah. So, like, I'd play it because I knew, like, people had never seen that.
And they're just like,
and
the
they're
fuck
like,
is
what
that?
The fuck is going on? Because it's so fast, but it's really not horrible, but, like, it's still, it looks hilarious.
Well, I remember that with Screaming Fire.
Oh,
on
really?
Guitar Hero World Tour. It was the first song that I ended up playing on World Tour, so it was the first song that I played that had an open note in it.
Oh, really?
And I was playing it with bass with my brother on doing the guitar, me doing the bass, going all the way through. There wasn't a single open note until I think the very last note. So there was just this purple bar that came across. I'm just like,
what is that?
What the fuck do I hit?
What
do I
do with that shit? I remember the first time I said it to or saw it too. I was like, wait, do I? Oh, I think I get it.
And then switching over to drums later, it's like, what kick? What? What's kick? What? It's like it's the same thing, just a
exactly.
Line
Dude, what about My Apocalypse, dude? I was going to say that. What did you guys think of that keyboard drop thing?
That's
is so weird.
Favorite. Hey, you know, it's a single, you know, there, right?
Really?
Yeah.
The verse riff is awesome. But like, so groovy.
But once again, dude, throughout this album, they go through transitions that don't fit for me. It
really?
It doesn't feel so well. Personally.
So I can agree with that. There is the moment where it switches up to the slower part of the song. I think it's right. I think I actually took this one down.
Oh, you want me to play it?
Oh, no, we don't need to play it. No, I don't have a time code for it.
Oh, okay. Damn.
But about halfway through a song, it cuts off and just slow guitar coming in.
Yeah, it's
and then
a really weird transition. They do that time to time.
Like, honestly, I groove with it. I like it.
I groove with the verse a lot, dude. I thought that verse riff was fucking so groovy. Like, it was like heavy, but still worked. My problem with this one is the chorus is so weak compared to the verse. Yeah. I thought the chorus was a step down for sure with how good the verses was. I think that's what held it back. But the fucking, dude, the drummer slays that bell, like, and that after the breakdown part, he's going, I love it, dude. This drummer, he smacks. What's his name? Daniel Erlandson. Erlandson. That guy's a legend, dude. Daniel's smacking on those drums.
That's
he can
awesome.
Fucking play. But yeah, the slow part at the, I think it's at the end, is it?
It's like at 3:55 or something. Yeah,
exactly at the halfway.
Not my favorite.
Yeah.
I think it ends up working because it carries into the solo, and the solo starts off slow and it carries with it. And then boom, it ends up picking up partway through the solo. And then from there, you get the last chorus.
Yeah, the solo, I agree with you, it works. But that slow part just like, it just seems so. There's nothing unique about it to me. Like, I didn't love it.
Yeah.
Didn't stand out.
It's like they listened to Master of Puppets and 20 years later went, oop. I could write something similar.
That.
Yeah.
That's the song.
So I'm going to guess we're all on the same page here. If you want peace,
I think this is a blowout.
Easily. If you want peace, ease. Again, that is my favorite song on this album.
Yeah, I was about to say, what do you think? If You Want Peace is the best song in the album?
I don't think so. I still don't think so.
I think I might agree with Sam, dude. After going back, I think it is the best song in the album. It's a banger, dude. Oh. It's a great one. And it's just everything. The keys work for it, I think. Like, and that's the thing that really takes away, especially once we get later in this album, I'll start getting more annoyed with like the keyboards because it's just like, oh my God, this is too much. Like, it's a little over the top. But it just works so well in this fucking song. You know, like I said, it's cheesy, but it fucking works. I love it. So If You Want Peace, Prepare for War gets the Pentagram of Truth. Track number 4, Punch Me, I Bleed versus Carry the Cross. Dude, why does the Punch Me, I Bleed intro remind me of another song?
I don't know what it is. And I don't slower
know.
Tempo.
Yeah, I don't know what song it is, but it fucking, like, there's a very, I'm going to find it. And maybe on one of our Think Agains, which will come back.
Yeah.
I'm going to find out which song sounds exactly like that intro, but it just sounds very similar or something.
I would actually agree with that. I don't know which one it is.
Yeah.
But.
And then the verses, come on, Metallica, right? Like, that's, it's more
it's
of like a sad
average,
but true.
Man. Was that? It's an average song.
It's pretty really average, is. But I think it still works. But
it does pick up like a 210. That's a head nodder right there. Yeah. But like, dude, everything else is just,
it's pretty average.
Honestly, I literally had nothing to say about it.
Really?
Yeah. I have nothing to say about this song.
You know what I wrote? Well, I put the isolated part is that like his isolated vocal parts, like where there's no guitar, just kind of drum in the rhythm. They don't sound good. Like, I don't like them, but I this is the part I put. If they played this live, this is like, I'd go get a beer. Like, as soon as they played that first note, I'd be like, hey, you guys want to drink?
Beer time.
You guys want to drink?
Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah, dude. But going on the arch enemy side, bro, Carry the Cross,
dude,
smacks, dude.
That is melodic.
That vocal tone is nasty.
Yeah.
Nasty. Fucking Angela destroys it, dude. They put like that weird effect. Like, I always call it the Where the Slime Lives.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because Dave Vincent puts it on his voice.
Yeah.
She rocks it on the song because it's the same thing. There's like isolated parts with just her voice.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit slower, but this one sounds like brutal, like nasty. And then, chorus on this one's okay, but then that 3-0, I think it's about 3 minutes, they hit this like melody that's just like,
yeah, I wrote it
ass.
Down. Yeah. I put it's 252, man. Oh,
252. Oh, you want it? You want it? You want it? Oh, let's do it.
Might as well.
Right, let's do it.
Jamming.
Fucking, which one was it? The,
Carry the Cross.
Carry the Cross.
That's 252. I gotta fix this.
Carry the Cross. Headphones on.
Let's see what we got.
It was which one? 252?
Yeah. I think that's the part you're talking about.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Dude, it's so chill.
Yeah.
Oh, that's very carcassy.
Yes, it is.
You know that's Michael Ahmad, baby.
The melody.
So over dramatic, like with the bends.
That scream right there.
Yes, exactly.
God, that part fucking smacks, dude. You're right. Yeah, man, I really like that part. Like I said, there's parts on the album, especially there, where I just think of Carcass. You know what I mean? I'm like, that's Michael, dude. Like,
dude,
but he just goes more melodic with Arch Enemy, obviously, than Carcass. But yeah, his style really shines through.
Yeah, a lot of Arch Enemy songs on this album do feel a lot more classic death metal than melodic in some areas.
Yeah, especially like you said, because the vocals yet had gone
it's
super melodic.
Mesh.
You know
what
I mean? It is a good mashup. I think this. You know, this is something I want to talk about too. Would you say this is you know what? No, I'll wait till we get to the halftime point. I'll wait till we get to the halftime point. But I'm going with Carry the Cross. I think this is easy, dude.
Yeah.
Carry the Cross, Pentagram of Truth.
Not difficult for me.
Yeah, for sure.
Carry the Cross because the Pentagram of Truth.
Next
so
one's fucking hard.
We are let's take the intermission. Let's take the intermission. 9 tracks, we'll take the intermission right now. And that's when we like to talk about the album covers. They have no bearing on the debate, but we will discuss them. Here's my opinion on these album covers. They fucking suck. Why are these album covers so bad? Is it
They're
the time
bad.
Period? The fucking geographic location of these bands? Is it the labels?
I don't know.
They are horrible.
So, honestly, of the two of them, I do think that Doomsday Machine has the better album.
Yeah, I go with Doomsday Machine just because fucking...
I don't know.
The Bottom just does the same thing every time. At least the Hexed one has a cool-looking Reaper on it.
It's
you know
the
what
coolest
mean?
One.
This one's
sure.
a Are You Dead? Yeah, I'm not liking it.
I'm not
it's
a fan
not my
of
favorite
one.
Album cover. But both of them, if I saw them at the record store, I would never pick them out because of the image.
No. You'd flip them over and go, oh shit, Nemesis is on this one, and then you'd buy it.
More like I flip it over and be like, Michael Amott plays for Arch Enemy. But yeah, not my favorite album cover. Which one would you go with?
I would go Doomsday.
Doomsday
also.
Machine. Yeah.
Honestly, I've looked at Are You Dead Yet's album cover many, many times in the past several years that I've listened to this album. I don't even know what it is, to be honest.
Really?
I can't even tell. It just looks
like the Reaper. It's the Reaper with like his fist, right? Yeah,
that's kind of what it is. Yeah.
Well, anyway,
maybe, I don't know. It was originally a really bad 250 by 250 pixel image that I first saw.
Oh my gosh.
That's always, especially if you downloaded it.
It's over.
Amazon.
Oh, okay. That's true too. Yeah. I was going to ask you, this is the question I was going to ask you. Okay. Would you say Doomsday Machine is the best Arch Enemy album? Is that your favorite, or which one is your favorite?
I would not say that it is my favorite, and I'm terrible with names when it comes to bands that I don't listen to as much as Amon Amarth or Dream Theater.
You think, which one? The one with...
I'll pull it up.
Jesus Christ. I can see the... I really like Stigmata.
Honestly, for me, War Eternal.
War Eternal. Yeah, that's sorry. Yeah,
that's the
what I was
newest
War
one, right?
No,
War Eternal is 2014.
Their newest one is actually Will Covered Power in Blood.
I didn't hear that one. I heard the War Eternal one. Yeah. That's the one I heard.
No, Covered in Blood.
No,
is
you heard the one. She's Will to Power or whatever. That's the one we heard, I believe.
No,
that's the one with like the eagle flies alone.
Oh, okay.
I think that's the one you're thinking of. Yeah, Will to Power. But so you'd be War Eternal, you'd say.
But Covered in Blood is an interesting one because they just released it last year.
Yeah,
and it's a cover album.
Really.
And it starts with...
See, that's what I'm saying. It's not the same one you're thinking of.
Not at all. But just some of the ones that I love off of it. It's got Breaking the Law.
Nice.
Okay.
That'd be cool.
With Alyssa singing?
Melodic?
Like a melodic scream to it?
Yeah. Wow. I mean, it's not...
That'd be interesting. Breaking the Law! Breaking the Law!
Oh, speaking of, did you hear Korn's Devil Went Down to Georgia? It's so fucking bad.
Say it again?
Oh,
who?
Korn covered...
Korn covered Devil Went Down to Georgia. There's some songs and some bands that don't mesh.
Don't
mesh.
To it.
And that's one of them. That's bad.
I gave it a shot.
Here's going to be the one for you off of this album. Give it a listen as soon as you can. Symphony of Destruction.
What?
Really? That sounds cool.
Yeah. How does she sing it?
So
you
I have it in my ear right now. Let's see it. I'm actually curious if these headphones can do like paired multiple, like I can hand it off to you. And
no,
you
I'll wait till the.
Yeah, let's wait.
Because if not, I'm going to lose track of the conversation. But as far as, so which, is this the only Arch Enemy album you've heard?
Yeah. I've only heard a bunch of their singles.
See, I've only done this one, War Eternal, and Stigmata. And Stigmata is before they had Angela. It's with the Dude Screamer. And there's some bangers on that album, dude. Yeah. There's one called like Sinister Manifesto.
I've heard a bunch of singles, and they got some good stuff.
Yeah, they have some good stuff.
I gotta dive deep into them.
They definitely have like, once they got, I think, to War Eternal, after that album, they kind of got like a formula down. And after that, they continue to just use the same... similar style, but it still works, so whatever.
We'll
you know
see
what I mean? It's catchy.
With the new album.
Yeah, that's very true. Okay, but what about on the Children of Bodom side? You think Are You Dead Yet best album?
No, Hex is my favorite.
Hex, really?
Hex
the new
is
one?
So good.
Dude. I don't know. I think I'd still go Hate
Follow
Breeder.
The Reaper,
I love Hate Breeder. This
Hex.
One, I'd say this one or Hate Breeder is the best.
This is the only album that I've listened to front to back for them. So I
really
more
see on opposite.
You
of
listen,
you.
Listen to the newest
to
one. I think
more.
You'd enjoy it. It's definitely not a cover to cover, but it's a great album.
Okay. No, dude, it's pretty close to cover to cover. It's fucking good.
What?
Yes, dude.
I don't know about that. I don't know about
Road,
that.
Hex.
No, dude, that weird one, Hecate's Nightmares, whack.
Yeah, they
dude.
Got some, no, that was not even that bad.
It's pretty bad, JJ.
I think
know.
It's better than this album.
It's not a cover to cover, but it was a good album. It was surprisingly a good
we'll
album.
We'll have to do that someday.
Anyway, so the album cover going Doomsday Machine. Let us move on to track number 5, In Your Face. This is actually a pretty hard one, too.
Dude,
I thought this
is the hardest one for me.
Yeah, it is one. In Your Face versus I Am Legend / Out for Blood.
I Am Legend, Out for Blood was so surprising.
Bro,
so fucking good.
No, I love the fucking... the intro is so sick. And the fucking groove on the guitar at first is really good. And then they go into that really fast.
It becomes a thrasher at 121.
So I want to use a time code real quick.
Let's do it, man. I wrote like 4 of them.
Off of I Am Legend, 147...
Oh, I wrote that too. That's funny.
Because it sounds like Frantic by Metallica. And that will be stuck in your head for the rest of the day,
oh,
and
no,
I apologize.
Don't do it to me.
147?
147.
Getting there. Bup, bup, bup. Oh. All right, let's see.
I hear that, though. You're living a lie. You're living a lie.
Go ahead. Dude, dance in that pit, bro.
Yeah.
Creeping like a hungry cat, dog. You know what I'm saying? Oh, dude, that's a good
one. It's a great song, but every single time that it comes on, I get frantic, stuck in my head afterwards.
Personally, it's my favorite song off the album. Dude, there's so many parts on this song, dude.
It would open.
It's a 151.
Like I said, when they get to that, like, more of the four, is it four on the floor? Whatever drummer's called that.
It has so many parts.
And you're fucking creeping.
At 3:29, it becomes a black metal song. At 151, it's a thrasher. The middle section, dude, it has so many parts.
So what you're saying is, just like the shortest straw, they couldn't decide which riff they wanted.
Dude, it's great, man.
Stop that. The shortest straw has been pulled for you, Sam.
It's one of my favorite Metallica songs.
Oh, really? Oh, I thought you were trying to dog on it.
No.
And then the ending's killer on this song. Dude, the song's fucking perfect.
I was going to say, one of my favorite parts is that isolated drum transition just slays, dude. Daniel again, man. Yeah. Just holding it down, man. And that solo section, too. But yeah, man. Because after he does like that hard like drum transition, then he starts going to the blastings, like you said.
Yeah.
I wouldn't call it black metal, but there's definitely the blasting starts getting me like, oh, fuck. Because it's the only song on the album, on both albums, where there's blasting.
No, I say it's black metal because that riff is...
It's a straight tremolo picking. Yeah. And he fucking kills it, too. But, dude, In Your Face, that's another classic, dude.
This is my favorite one, dude, from both of them. These two are so fucking hard.
Yeah.
And the chorus is hilarious.
But the chorus is. In Your Face is another one where he's having a bit of an issue grasping the English language.
A little bit.
I don't give a flying fuck, motherfucker.
Okay, that was the thing. Yeah. I love that when I heard it when I was...
When I was a kid, I loved it.
I loved it. But now I'm like...
That's even more cheesy than anything else. That's like Die Motherfucker Die by Dope.
That song is still good. Dope, dude. I don't care.
No, JJ, it's not that good, dude. But
JJ, what did your parents do to you?
Dude, Sam's so right. That part has not aged well. It's so cheesy.
So
I don't give a flying fuck, motherfucker. I don't give a flying fuck, motherfucker.
Like I do still love the song, but that one moment does kind of take me out.
Because honestly, the chorus is awesome. Say one more word, I double dare you. It's what does he say? It's my world. You're in it. It'll take you down in a minute. Just like, dude. That was my rant about Finnish people, okay? Is this... And you know what? This is not racist because I'm half Norwegian, and I guess we're Scandinavian. I wouldn't consider them Scandinavians, but whatever.
This is starting to sound a little political.
No. Here's what I'm saying about Finnish people, dude. Is it just me, or are they just, like, really into cheesy stuff? Like, there's so many... This is the example. I mean, Children of Bodom, we've already got the cheese here. The keyboards, these lyrics, so cheesy. Yep. Then you got bands like Nightwish. I swear to God,
Nightwish is great.
I like them.
Fantastic.
But don't tell me they're not cheesy.
They're pretty cheesy.
That guy with the long beard, he's just too much. You know.
Now I'm thinking Wishmaster, and you got a point.
Like,
I mean, you got everything in that bag. You got a pirate. You got Gandalf.
That's true. They're all there, dude. And the Finnish people love it.
Where did Alestorm come from? Are they also Finland?
I don't know if they're Finnish.
I don't think
you know who I will bring up? Who's the cheesiest band we've ever seen live? I really want you to hear your opinion on this.
The cheesiest band.
Cheesiest band we've ever seen live. And I wonder if we're going to settle on the same band.
I can't even think right now.
Sonata Arctica, dude.
Oh, they are pretty fucking cheesy.
That's cheese.
That was some cheese.
They got the classic Indian wolves in the back.
That was too much. And then he's like, you know what? We're always pitting. Let's start dancing. Let's ballroom dance. And I'm like, dude, where are we right now? Like, it's cool for its own thing, but for some reason, I don't know why it's always Finnish bands.
The cheesiest
band
we ever saw was King Dude.
King Dude was a gimmick. Oh my God. I'm sorry for all the King Dude fans out there, but King Dude fucking sucks.
He sucks.
What's the song? Tell me what's that light? Lucifer's the light. Tell me what's that light? Lucifer's the light.
What the fuck?
He's like gospel for the devil.
Oh, yeah, wow.
It's just like a guy with his acoustic guitar that plays like songs about the devil. And you're like, this is such a gimmick.
Hilarious.
Dude, it's bad.
It's kind of funny, but after seeing 45, because when we saw Ghost for the first time, he opened.
That sounds like someone that would open for Ghost.
Exactly. Yeah. But you sit there for 45 minutes. You're like, it's pretty funny for one song. And then you're like,
A year later, Ghost let Tribulation open up for them.
That's
a fucking
way
band.
Better. You're talking about a whole different fucking league between Tribulation
and
fucking King Dude.
Yeah, King Dude, that's from what you're telling me, that just sounds like open mic.
You can still keep that atmosphere, but fucking banging, dude.
It's literally I'm dogging on him too much. I'm sure there's King Dude fans out there, but I'm not one of them. King Dude can lick my left nut, dude. I'm fucking.
Leave the right one hanging?
And leave the right one hanging, dude. I don't give a fuck. The right one is.
Yo, give a flying fuck, motherfucker.
Exactly.
You're still hooked.
Oh my God. No, I like that one. But like I said, Finnish people are cheesy, but King Dude, maybe he could be the cheesiest.
Yeah,
but all I'm saying is the way they dress too. Because remember the Sonata Arctica guy had like ripped jeans, just his hair. It was just too much.
Dude, it's that's also just it's Sonata style. Arctica. Yeah.
That's
they've been around for so long and their style has changed so much.
But there's so many Finnish bands who fit that mold. Yep. And I don't know what it is. And I'm sure the Finnish community is going to come after me. I don't really give a fuck.
See, it's funny.
Norway and Sweden have better music. Challenge me outside
of the music, the Finnish people are, their humor is very dry. So I find it really funny that when they're going on stage, like performing like that, they let it all fly out.
It's that's true.
I find that weird.
I mean, I don't hate all the music. Like I said, I like Nightwish. I like Children of Bodom. There's just an element there that I'm just like, all right, dude, could be like one of my favorite bands, but there's something about you that just holds you back. You
know? I think a good third of my music that doesn't come from America comes from Finland.
Really? A third?
I would roughly. This is
I would say that about Scandinavia, but not one country in Scandinavia, because there's just so many Swedish, Norwegian, Danish.
I got a lot. Of Sweden, Switzerland.
Switzerland's not part of Scandinavia.
Well, no, but I'm just saying, in the general area, like that Northern Europe. I listen to them like a fucking lot.
Oh yeah, man. And you know me and Soilwork, dude, about the Swedish bands. The new Soilwork stuff is just killing it.
Old
In Flames, even some of the newer stuff, but not the newest album I didn't like, or the last two.
The re-recordings suck balls.
What'd you think about that Kalanian re-record? We'll have to do a whole review on that. I don't want to touch front of it right now.
I'm not a big fan of In Flames, to be honest.
Really?
Yeah. I've always had trouble getting into them. You throw me a song or two to listen to that's like, these are bangers, I'll give them a shot.
Yeah, I'll give you an In Flames playlist, because like for me, I was just like a diehard for so long, but...
Oh, yeah. The first four are fucking phenomenal.
They're cheesy now. Okay, but they're Swedish, so they're cool. Sorry, Finland. All right, guys. So, which one are you guys going for? Fuck, we didn't even decide.
Yeah, dude, this
fuck,
is close.
Songs are
dude,
we on?
Okay.
This is really close.
This was really hard, but I don't give a flying fuck. Motherfucker ruined it. So I'm going with I Am Legend, Out for Blood.
I'm going with I Am Legend because I was blown away with that song.
Honestly, I was going within your face because that was one of the first songs off this album, other than If You Want Peace, that I heard. And like, I do still love it.
Nostalgia
that
factor.
Take me just, too much.
Yeah.
Nostalgia factor. Nostalgia plays a big part in my life.
Definitely.
I heard the main menu theme to Mario Tennis the other day, and I just, I went back 20
the
years.
N64 one?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, I went back 20 years, man.
Let me pull that one up so everyone can listen to it. But I Am Legend, I think it's aged better for sure. Okay, guys, let's go on to track number 6, Next in Line versus Skeleton Dance.
Oh, I have things to say about Next in Line.
Guys,
I think this is a blowout.
This is a blowout. We're doing 3-2-1.
I don't know which way we're going. I'm just going to say this real quick. Next in Line's chorus sucks.
Oh, well, there you go.
There we go.
You
know the Sam gave it away. We could have done a 3-2-1.
Sorry. I had to say that before we said anything else. I hate that chorus.
Yeah, Next in Line, the chorus is pretty bad. And, the guitar solo though is really good. The intro is all right, but the intro starts good.
But it's bass driven.
When the keys came in, I literally laughed. Like I literally laughed. I was like, no, come on, come on, dude, that's too much. Like that's just it.
I know
can't do
this
it.
Song is bad, but dude, Skeleton Dance is actually a really
good
song.
Skeleton Dance is a smacker.
Oh, yeah,
so good. I never heard that one before. So glad Sam told us to do this because I would have never heard this song.
Oh, it's on my playlist now after listening to all of these back and forth.
Oh yeah,
again.
Man, that's definitely.
And I put that 3-minute riff is fucking carcass butter, dude.
Dude, put it on. Put
I'm gonna
it
have
too.
To do it. I'm gonna
put
it on.
Put it too.
Fucking what I say? So 3 good. Minutes.
Yeah,
he said 3 minutes. Skeleton Dance.
It's right after the solo, right?
Yeah, it's like right there. Let me hear it. This part of it. Oh my god.
Yes.
Come on. That's melodic. Death metal to the max. I would have known that
I was dead. Every metalhead
to
learn how to play guitar.
This band
probably tried to learn that riff.
Oh, I know. That riff is smacking, dude. Yeah, man. That's after I heard that too, I was like, oh, that's for sure a Carcass-esque sounding thing. Yeah. But definitely different in its own, you know, Arch Enemy does it a little bit different than Carcass. I don't think they're in B tuning like Carcass.
How long did Michael stay with the band?
And well, which one? Arch Enemy?
Yeah.
That's his band. He's still in there. It. That's his band.
Oh, he's still here.
Yeah. It was Chris that left.
He started Arch Enemy. Yeah. Yeah.
Chris left, came back, left. I think came back when again, but he's officially gone.
He joined Carcass and Necroticism, and he was on Necroticism, Hard Work, and a Swan Song, and then he left after they broke up or took a hiatus. He wasn't on Surgical, but after that, he formed Arch Enemy and did that. You know what I mean?
Full time. Okay. Which, that's what
speaking
it was.
What's his name? God, I can't pronounce that first name. The bassist for Arch Enemy.
Mm-hmm.
He was the one that played bass.
Charlie D'Angelo.
There we go.
D'Angelo.
He played bass for Merciful Fate on Into the Unknown.
Oh, wow.
Oh, what? Really?
That's pretty cool.
That's fucking cool. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, which is my favorite album the King Diamond has put out.
Yeah.
It's so good. That and Them. Them is so good.
Yeah. I will say this, though, because we're talking about Amat with Carcass and Arch Enemy. Carcass or Arch Enemy?
Oh, Carcass all day.
You haven't heard enough Arch Enemy, though.
No, I can't.
For me, what I've heard so far, it's for sure Carcass. Carcass is like one of my favorites.
I'm going to have to listen to some Carcass then.
Oh, you need some Carcass in your life, Sam.
Dude, Heartwork is a top five metal album, like, period.
Top five metal album, Heartwork?
So good, dude.
Necroticism's better.
No, it's not. You're out of your mind, dude.
Why? And then all the grindcore fans are going
to
be like, no, it's not. It's Symphonies of Sickness.
Why is Justin obsessed with that album?
No, Symphonies is good. Justin's right. Symphony smacks. I can't do Reputrefaction, dude. That one sucks.
Maybe it's that one.
Like, I can't do it.
Yeah.
Symphony's got some good one, dude. What's it called? Crepitating Bowel Erosion.
Yeah.
Fucking that one that Justin's like, I can't think of the fucking name. And then, of course, Ruptured and Purulence, dude.
Dude, Carcass is just really good. Swan Song and Surgical Sea are awesome.
Swan Song is not awesome.
I like it.
It's good.
It's
okay.
Some good
it's
stuff
okay.
in there, dude.
But it has some really whack stuff. Twinkle, Twinkle, Black Star.
Why, no one ever serious?
He literally, the chorus is Twinkle, Twinkle, Black Star.
I don't care. Oh, that song smacks.
Why do I feel like we've talked about this before?
Yeah. Oh, we probably have. But anyway, Skeleton Dance gets the Pentagram of Truth. So let's go on to track number 7, Bastards of Bodom versus Mechanic God Creation.
Dude, I love the bass intro on Bastards.
I was just about the same thing. I put the bass intro's awesome. Once again, the keys come in and I'm like,
But the guitar work's great in this song.
No, dude, you're right. The guitar work is really good. Yeah. The guitar work is great. And the, what's it called? That 215 riff just slays, man.
Yep, I put that too. I put 214.
We haven't done a sample of Children of Bodom. You want to do that one or you want to wait
for another one? No, I'll wait.
Okay, he's got another one. Yeah. I definitely have one more from fucking Arch Enemy. I want to throw in there, but I didn't want to.
Throwing in a lot of Arch Enemy.
I know, dude. But so I hadn't heard a lot of these riffs, and I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I would think Children of Bodom people have heard them more than Arch Enemy. I don't know if that's true or not.
Ultimately, I can agree with that. Children of Bodom,
especially
Bodom
especially these two albums. I think Are You Dead Yet's a huge album. Was that?
I thought Arch Enemy was bigger.
I think Arch Enemy's bigger. Big. They're definitely bigger now, but I'm saying Doomsday Machine isn't their biggest album by any. They got really big after War Eternal. Yeah. That was like the,
Stratosphere.
Yeah. And then now they're headlining, where they still are, since that point, just headlining massive festivals in Europe.
I know. It's insane.
Which is cool. But man, that Bastards of Bodom, it's okay. I mean, it's just a...
I'm just not a fan of Mechanic God Creation.
See,
That's not my favorite. It's a weaker song.
I'm not so sure about that. I mean, there are some points about it that I actually did really like, and I'm having to look over my notes just to remember. Because I have Bastard of Bodom in my ear right now. So.
Yeah. But the Mechanic God Creation, dude, I didn't love the clean guitar intro.
Pace and...
But the tone of the clean guitar when it started, I did not like. Like, I thought it did not sound good. But
it
then
seems
once.
Off.
It does seem a little. Like, it just doesn't sound good. But once
I think that is. I switched it over. I have that in my head now. So I actually do like how the chords are going in the intro.
Yeah, I just don't like the tone of the guitar. Like, it doesn't sound good. Like, it's just, they could have done a better clean tone, but I'm sure these guys, I don't know.
I think it's supposed, at least in my eyes, and this might be someone putting words into the mouth of an artist, but I feel like it kind of subverts the rest of the song, kind of makes you feel uneasy before it actually begins going.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, I feel like it's giving you kind of that uneasiness from the start.
Yeah, that's true. But once it hits you with the electric guitar, that part, I'm like, oh, fuck.
That's
and then
when
it goes,
kicks on.
Then when it goes to a fucking thing. But, dude, I have to play this riff because it made me laugh so hard. Is this not Mortal Coil? This Mortal Coil from Carcass. It's the same riff. All right? And I got to be the riff police over here.
Oh, my
Tell
God.
Tell me this is not fucking Carcass right here. Let me get rid of the Mechanic God Creation. What was it? 127. Yeah, and Carcass definitely has more of that.
Right there with the chorus when it goes in with the higher pitch part. I really like how that
is. Yeah. I do too. But that riff, dude.
Dude, that's too funny.
That riff is fucking Carcass. That it's is hilarious. Definitely, it's literally this Mortal Coil.
It's definitely a sample.
That, dun, 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 dun. But it's in, what tune are they playing? They're playing in D standard?
No, they're playing in C.
C standard, and then Carcass is in B standard, so it's bum 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 bum, just heavier. But it sounds, when I heard it, I was just like, "Time for Mortal Coil," but it wasn't it. But anyway, that made me laugh. But still, the song I think as a whole is better than Bastards of Bodom. That's my two cents.
What? No, dude, I like Bastards better. I really like
Bastards of Bodom, but I'm going with Mechanic God Creation.
Wow,
there we go, dude. You're wrong, JJ. Mechanic God Creation gets the Pentagram of Truth. All right, we're on to track number 8, Trash, Lost, and Strung Out versus Mach Kampf.
Dude, Trash, Lost is another gem.
Yeah?
I think it's a gem, dude. It's fucking banging, dude.
Yeah, the build-up riff is fucking cool. And it's I think that where he puts that, like,
dude,
you know,
put
that
on 215 for me.
215? Okay. 215, I'll do it now. I'm going to what I'm saying.
Fucking awesome.
215. We're finally getting a Bodom sample
dude,
in
let's
here.
Let's get heavy.
We need a sample.
I know. 215, right?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Good old Bodom.
Dude, I love Bodom.
Their song titles sometimes just make me laugh, like Bodom Beach Terror.
To get off the screen too?
Oh, there we go, baby.
Yeah.
Don't catch me in the pit. I'm about to throw something. Oh, they were creeping.
See, I do legit.
Oh, shit. My bad about the volume there, guys.
Amazing.
Still getting used to being the audio engineer.
Changing it up.
There's not really enough room in this room for a fourth person.
We don't have young Jamie. Young Garrett. Young Garrett somewhere else. He taught me the ways and left to a mythical land. But
good job, Garrett. Good job, young Garrett. You shall now, for hencemore, be known as Garrett.
Just Garrett. But that part's cool. But like I said, they give you a smacking riff like that,
and then that cheesy ass, like,
I don't know. I love it more than you guys do. But
yeah. I like it. It's just, I don't love it.
Yeah.
I just feel like they could build more off of that.
I think so, too. Really? I actually enjoyed Mach Kampf a bit more.
I did, too.
Mach Kampf, yeah. Dude, some hard riffage. But tell me. That first drum intro did not remind you of Pull Harder on the Strings of Your Martyr by Trivium.
Actually, yes. Yes, that's what I've had stuck in my head this whole
time. Yes, it sounds
every
like...
Every single time.
Someone... Who ripped off who? Okay, which one? This is 2005.
Oh,
damn.
Shit.
We gotta fuck. If I ever meet Matt... Oh, no. Who did that?
No,
who's
the
drummer?
Travis.
Travis,
yeah.
If I ever meet Travis, I'm like, did you listen to Little Arch Enemy or what'd you do? It's so similar, but...
Oh, wait a minute. It's 04. Never mind. Arch Enemy copied that.
Uh-oh. Arch Enemy getting a little bit of trouble.
See, honestly,
copying the young kids.
Shit. I feel like this album has had a lot of those moments where it's just like, it sounds so similar to another one.
Mm-hmm. Maybe they... I don't know.
I agree, but the drums are just killer, especially when he gets to that 145 where he's holding kind of that tom beat and he's got the off thing.
Yeah.
Dude, he's rocking it, man. Like, he fucking destroys. And there's
would you say this is the best drum track on the
album? Yeah, I definitely enjoy this one so much, dude. It's just like a first minute there. He goes on like, he puts on a clinic. But they're just, once again, so much groove. That riff at 220 on this song fucking smacks. And then great melodic solo, I thought. The faster solo on this one I love, but the melodic solo is really good.
Yeah.
So for that reason, I'm going Mach Kampf, dude.
Really?
I'm sorry. Yeah.
Honestly, I'm in line with that too.
I really do like Trash better than Bastards. It actually surprised me, but I don't think it's as good as Mach Kampf.
What, dude? Trash is a great song. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
I never said I never said it was bad.
No, I didn't say it was
bad. I like it.
I still think it's good.
I'm here for the power struggle. I'm here for Mach Kampf.
Mach Kampf, dude. Yeah. So Mach Kampf gets the Pentagram of Truth. And we are on to the last track here, fellas. We Are Not Gonna Fall versus Slaves of Yesterday. Dude, I think this is the easiest pick, dude. Slaves of Yesterday smacks, dude. I think it might be my favorite song on the album.
So
it's
good.
A nice ender. Nice way to go out.
I'm going to put on my a riff again, dude. This 28 seconds, oh my God, dude. I was fucking feeling it, man. I was so surprised at how good this song was. But let me just fast forward a little bit.
Let's do it. That's so garbage.
God damn!
Reminds me of that Carter song.
Dude, tell me if you saw that live, you would just be like, who the fuck is this? Pick it up, dude. Get that pick. Move it. Give him the jazz stuff. But what's it? Bro, I was feeling the shit out of that, dude. Yeah, man. I really like that.
It's a great ender to an album.
Yeah, and they bring that riff back on the very end, and then they fade it out. I love it, dude. That two-minute breakdown is fucking nasty.
It is,
it's a top song on the album. It's a fucking staple, dude.
It's not a close battle.
I was, at the end of this, like, for Doomsday Machine, I was so surprised at how consistent it was, because that song smacks. But anyway, sorry, I went on a tangent. Y'all tell me, what'd y'all think of We're Not Gonna Fall?
It's okay. It's just another random, like a regular Bodum song. Nothing spectacular. Nothing average. That pops up.
I had almost nothing to say about it when I was taking my notes. By this point, I was burned out because I was doing the notes for our next episode, and I was also doing the notes for this episode at the same time. I did the notes for the next episode before this one, and so I was going into this one, and it's just like I need to sit down and listen to something else.
No, but even if you give it a good thorough listen, which I did, it was okay.
I've listened to these albums a lot since our hiatus, since y'all's hiatus, I'm guess. But since then, it's just like I've listened to these albums off and on, just trying to make sure that I'm ready for when I come back with you guys.
Yeah,
and like this one, I have legitimately had nothing to say.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's pretty average, dude.
It's a song. It's not bad. It's not. I wouldn't say it's good, but it's definitely not bad. It's just.
I agree.
A song.
It's just average. Like the intro starts pretty decent, and then once again, the keys for me, I'm like, but then the double bass kind of saves it. I think chorus is okay. Riff after the chorus, though, I think fucking slays.
Yeah.
The end of the album, I think it's a fitting end to the album. It's very much in line with Bodum, but not an amazing song. Just okay. But where I think Slaves is just a fucking killer. So we all going Slaves?
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, did everyone on the fucking pod hear that riff? I mean, Jesus Christ, that riff. Why is there not more Arch Enemy like that, dude? That riff smacks.
Seriously. It needs to
so
happen.
Good.
So real quick, before we go any farther, did y'all happen to hear one of the bonus tracks, or actually just the bonus track for the North American release of Are You Dead Yet?
Yeah, which one? Hit Me Baby One More Time? Or
no, that's one
that's
of the
Japanese.
That's the Japanese release.
No, they did a Ramones cover.
Yeah.
Which one?
Somebody put something in my drink.
That was Comedy Gold.
It was terrible.
It was Comedy
Gold. Such a
bad
cover.
Well, I mean, they did Hit Me Baby One More Time, and they did another one.
They did Talk Dirty to Me by
Talk Dirty to Me.
Which I would love to hear that, to be honest.
That one actually works. That's the best of those three covers, but it's still.
Rebel Yell would have been good to hear.
Rebel Yell would have been interesting. Yeah. Because that's the UK bonus.
Yeah. That's ridiculous. I haven't heard that one. But I remember he did Umbrella by Rihanna.
Did he really?
Yeah, that's funny. One's just...
So they just have fun covering things
they have
that
fun
are not metal.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, Children of Bodom, you know they're giving like a fun like party vibe. And back in those days, definitely they were like known as the drinkers. Alexi, we all fucked up or whatever. Or they said those guys drank a lot, but... I don't think so much nowadays.
See, I don't
maybe
get that.
Drugs, because the dude's... Oh, yeah. Have you seen the guy?
That's what I was going to bring up when we saw him live, dude. Okay,
that's
everyone out
scary.
There, can we talk about this? What is going on with Alexis?
I couldn't keep my eyes off him, dude. Like his muscles are like this big.
Are you serious?
Dude, like scary skinny.
Yeah.
Like I don't know what happened. He looks like
he's just been doing meth or heroin.
I don't know,
shit.
Dude. But it was
I don't know. And then I had told JJ like right after that show because I did the VIP and I met all of them. And when I met him, it, just like when you give him a handshake, it was just so flimsy and like he just looked weak. And I was like, dude, what is going on, man? Like, and but the other bandmates, there just seemed to be like a weird tension, like during the meet and greet. Like, so I told JJ, and I remember telling you after that show that like I was like, I don't think we're gonna see Children of Bodom again. Like, and then they broke up. Like a year later, I was like, I knew it. Like, there was something up.
I still killed it though.
Is Alexi part of the new?
No,
new
he
band?
Is. That's
he
just,
is
yeah,
the
that's,
only one.
Yeah.
That
he's
stayed.
The only one.
Yeah,
okay.
All the other guys left.
So
I think.
They because I knew Roop left before all of that. So
yeah, Roop left,
they had
and
like
then
a contract, so they couldn't. He couldn't keep the name or something.
Yeah,
like that.
And then Jana left or Yane. I don't know how you say it.
I'm guessing that maybe y'all are right that he had a drug problem and everyone else just they didn't want to deal with it anymore.
Maybe, and like it just. And then, dude, I will, like, his vibe, like his presence as a frontman was just like, was not there. But although his vocal tone did sound pretty good when he was screaming, but maybe he was like a low volume screaming.
Was
like,
great.
And the guitar work's fantastic. I was surprised at how good he was, but I was like, dude, something seems up.
But the vibe wasn't there.
And then remember that a classic San Antonio, dude, that fucking guy like, hey, bro, when it was all quiet, hey, get that guy a fucking sandwich.
Oh, yeah.
That's San Antonio, dude, right there.
And me and JJ start laughing, dude, but we were with
that. That's my buddy Ruben right there. He'll yell that.
I know, and
he should have said taco though.
He should have said taco. What a fucker, dude! Hey, bro, get this guy some fucking
get him taco.
Yeah, get him a breakfast pirata, fuck it, from Taco P.
Get him some barbacoa.
Get him something, dude. Jesus Christ, he looked bad. But what? I always remember that because Sarah, she was all offended. She's like, hey, "Don't fucking say that. He might have a problem."
Oh, I know. She went hard.
Because we were with a this chick that she goes. She just shows a lot. She's friends with Stefan, who's on the show regularly, and she went with us to that show, and he was right behind her, and she turned around and, like, scolded him, like, what the fuck is your problem? Like, because, I mean, obviously, we don't know. Maybe he's got body dysmorphia. Maybe he's got anorexia. Yeah, he's got something up. I wouldn't have said the joke, but I did laugh. I thought it was a funny joke.
Yeah, it was pretty funny.
I'll laugh at other people's expense when it, you know, from time to time.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
But, yeah, that's what I wanted to bring up from the Children of Bodom show. But, yeah, man, so anyway... Slaves of Yesterday won, so let's get down to the end here, the conclusion to find out which album is better. Are You Dead Yet? Had 3 pentagrams of truth, which means Doomsday Machine is the winner of episode 47 with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pentagrams.
I think it was going
to
be
What'd you guys think? What'd you guys think of that results?
I think he's actually right. Like, going in open-minded, dude, it's head to toe is pretty fucking good.
When I recommended these two albums, I did not expect it to go in this direction. Mm-hmm. But as I was listening to the two albums back-to-back, this is exactly how I felt. We had disagreements on which of my songs I thought, oh, this one's better than this one and all that stuff. Nemesis should have won.
Yeah.
But either way,
it would have been more of a blowout if Nemesis won.
Yeah, either way, Arch Enemy.
I think In Your Face probably could have won.
See,
right?
That's my but thing. It's like, I think In Your Face would have been.
It still would have been Arch Enemy. But anyway, what's it called? I think I agree with this. Like, when I first looked at it, when you first recommended it, I'd only heard Are You Dead Yet all the way through, not Doomsday. I'd only heard a couple songs. But I was just like, there's no way you can compete. Those first 4 songs are so fucking good.
Yeah, I agree.
Or Punch My Bleed's not that good. But those first 3 songs are like, dude, there's no way.
Yeah.
But I forgot. Yeah, it does take a little bit of a dip where Children of Bodom gets
the
average.
B-sides
where the B-sides for Arch Enemy only get better. Like, they are fucking good. Skeleton Dance, Mechanic God Creation, Mock Comp, and Slaves of Yesterday are fucking great.
They're
and so
damn,
is I Am Legend, Out for Blood. Like, this is a great album, so I really got to thank Sam for turning us on to it like that.
Of course.
That was a fucking joy, dude. And I always want more mellow death in my life, I was happy for that. What do you think, Jay? You thought it was pretty
fair? I agree with what you said, yeah. I think it's pretty much what the outcome is what it is.
Yeah.
If we were to rank these albums, yeah.
Okay. Anything else to say? We all got it out.
So there was the other thing that I wanted to talk about. I think we've talked about this on a previous episode, but you and I going to go see Arch Enemy.
Oh, yeah.
And we had no idea that the other one was there.
That was hilarious. That was funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it was the concert that we were talking about with At the Gates and Amon Amarth and all that.
Yeah.
And my buddy George bought the tickets for me and my wife, Shauna, because we didn't have the money at the time.
Yeah.
And so we just showed up at the Aztec. He handed us, he was just like, here, just sent me a quick text of two of the tickets with the QR code.
That's a real friend right there.
That's a real friend.
That is pretty dope.
And I asked him, it's like, dude, when do you need me to pay you back? He's like, don't.
Damn.
Real friend.
Yeah.
Because those tickets were pricey. They were like $50.
Yeah.
Hey, I gave you my machine head ticket.
After fees and everything.
Fuck you.
But he actually, he's been in
you owe me, dude. I drive your ass all over the goddamn country.
But I think he's been in Belgium for like the last couple months or
really?
Visiting family.
Yeah.
But he so we went in, we were there. I was standing in line for merch for like a long time. The merch line just to get to a Arch Enemy was
ridiculous.
Was forever.
Yeah.
But looped around the top. Anyone that's been to the Aztec, like
it's a two-story it's a two-story theater and there's like a stairwell and the line for the merch always fucking
it's a great venue.
Goes up.
Though.
Yeah.
It's
beautiful.
It's beautiful looking. Sometimes the sound can be off, but I think it's
depends
honestly
on the mixing too.
Yeah, and I think when you're on the floor, like for some reason does not sound as good as when you're on one of those
bleachers. You're probably right.
Almost like
Killswitch, that was the worst time we ever saw them.
Oof.
Really?
Yeah,
dude, they sounded bad.
See, I've seen
Testament
Amon Amarth
sounded
there.
Really bad.
Who?
Testament.
Really? Testament sounded
Testament
bad
sounded
there?
Bad.
Yeah,
that
they
was
sounded
it
really
was like
bad.
Too loud. Like you just like it sucked cuz now Testament's tours with Gene Hoglan and Steve DiGiorio.
That's fucking cool.
So you're like
be amazing to see.
Exactly, yeah, but they don't exactly. Like I could not hear Steve at all. Like at all. Damn, it was
dude,
just
the sound
I couldn't hear
was
it.
Bad.
Even Sepultura didn't sound that good that
they
night.
Sound, yeah, they sounded okay.
But for some reason Prong sounded
Prong
amazing.
And Ghost sounded fucking great.
Yeah.
So it just depends on
I think it obviously always depends on the audio tech of the band, right?
That's
like
true.
Some audio techs are great.
Zach
they
Sabbath sounded
with
good. Even though he did too
it
many
was
squealies.
Loud as fuck.
He
though.
Did so many squealies, it's insane.
Yeah. He did just too many goddamn solos. I never want to see Zach's fucking wild do whittly woos for
oh,
fucking
he's
40
just
minutes.
Constantly pinching. Just
I know
constantly.
Pinching. Oh, he needs to pinch a loaf or something. Get that out of him. I'm fine with the pinch harmonics, yeah. But my problem is where he just does whittly woos for like 10 minutes, and I'm like, that's
oh, yeah.
Cool, I guess. Well,
the reason
good.
That I can't really listen to a lot of Black Label anymore.
Yeah. It's just like conclude the goddamn solo or switch key. Do something.
This
yeah.
Was War Pigs, this was a solo.
Oh god. Exactly. He turned War Pigs into 20 minutes and not for a good reason.
Oh, my God. But, so, yeah. Back to the story. So, I think that it was when Arch Enemy was playing and my wife went to go get another drink for me. I was because she's not into it as much as I am.
Yeah.
She walked over to go grab a drink and you saw her there.
Yeah, that's right. That's right, I did. But I didn't. I
you
never
didn't
met
her
before. Yeah.
You had never met her. I think you had maybe seen a picture or two on Facebook.
That's why I recognized
like,
her. I'm like, is that Sam's
familiar.
Wife? Nah, I don't think so. And then the day after on Facebook, you're like, I was there. I was like,
I post a picture of me and her together, and you look at it. It's just like, dude, I saw your wife.
Yeah. I was like, God damn it, we should have fucking hung out or something.
Yeah. I had
that was
to
a
work.
Good show.
It sucked, dude.
Yeah, dude,
I wish
if
I been there.
Dude, fuck if work. I had known, like, we would have gotten you out of it. We would have called Walmart. There is a bomb. No, I'm joking.
Oh.
I'm joking. But no, like, dude, the three of us going to a fucking concert? That would
yeah.
Be badass.
We need to go. Yeah. We need to go. When the fucking shit opens up again, yep. Man, I can't
it
wait.
It will happen.
Oh, that'd be true. Because they're doing the sickness tour, aren't they?
They're supposed to restart it back up.
Okay, hell yeah. I'd go with you to that for sure. Because, I mean, the sickness, I mean, it's just a classic since I was a kid. Like,
it'd be a classic.
Especially that we did the debate. That'd be fun to go do it.
Yeah.
But anyway, that all being said, today, Arch Enemy Doomsday Machine is the album that won on episode 47. If you think Are You Dead Yet's better, what's their opinion, JJ?
You're wrong.
You're fucking wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, motherfuckers, like and subscribe. Keep on headbanging as always. Don't let the COVID get you down. Go start a circle pit in your back.
That's
Yar!
Right. Peace
like
out,
like a
my
real
friends.
Motherfucker. Peace out. We'll see you on the next episode.
Peace.
Motherfuckers. Peace.